The impacts of climate change are so vast that it's impossible to predict exactly how it's going to play out, right? But there are two things that we can be pretty sure of. One, every time it snows anywhere in the world, someone's uncle is going to be like, what happened to global warming? And two, the hottest year ever recorded will likely be whatever year it currently is. Otherwise, we would have called our show something else. In the coming years, extreme heat will impact everything in our world, from microorganisms to geopolitics. But in this episode, I want to focus on how it'll impact our bodies. Trust me, I'm a doctor. Well, I was a doctor on TV. When we get too hot, and I tell you this as a non-medical doctor, our body cools itself by evaporating sweat. And if we can't sweat, it heats up. And if it heats up too much, we die. That simple, harsh fact is going to completely reshape our world over the coming decades. And to understand why, we need to understand something called the wet bulb temperature. Now, basically, it's a combination of heat and humidity that's measured by a thermometer bulb wrapped in a wet cloth. That's the wet bulb. If the air is dry, the water, like our sweat, evaporates off the cloth, which cools the thermometer. If the air is really humid, the water, like our sweat, can't evaporate, so the temperature stays where it is. Dry heat is less dangerous because the human body can sweat and adapt its temperature. But at a wet bulb temperature of just 35 degrees Celsius or 95 degrees Fahrenheit, the body can no longer adapt. It overheats and, technical term, you die. Now, thankfully, that level of heat and humidity is still pretty rare for now. But by 2050, NASA climate models show that South Asia, the Persian Gulf, and the Red Sea will start hitting wet bulb temperatures that could make those areas increasingly uninhabitable. And by around 2070, the same thing will likely happen in Arkansas, Missouri, and Iowa. Even now, extreme heat is killing hundreds of thousands of people around the world each year. If humans want to stick around, we need to adapt. We need to think about the future of cooling. When it comes to staying cool, we have several options. For example, we could just dress in lighter clothing. But here in America, when a heat wave hits, the first thing we usually do is turn on the air conditioner. Unfortunately, if that AC is hooked to a dirty grid, we're effectively cooling the indoors by heating the outdoors. Air conditioners use about 10% of all electricity produced in the US, which releases about 117 million tons of CO2 a year. Meanwhile, in poorer countries where it's getting especially hot, thanks to rich countries' decades of fossil fuel emissions, air conditioners are often financially out of reach. But as economies in the global South grow, that will change. By mid-century, about two-thirds of the world's households are expected to have air conditioners, with China, India, and Indonesia accounting for roughly half that. That demand is obviously completely understandable, and it'll put an enormous strain on electrical capacity. That means more power outages and a huge spike in emissions. So if we want to avoid serious climate blowback, humans need to rethink how we keep cool. We could use materials and designs that optimize homes for cooling, or design urban landscapes with more vegetation and water to lower temperatures of entire neighborhoods. And don't sleep on fans. Fans use 30 to 50 times less energy than air conditioning. They also allow our bodies to better acclimatize to the heat. And obviously, if you want to be a fashion icon, you can just build them directly into your jacket. In the commercial space, one option favored by green designers are cool roofs. I know these sound like roofs that go to Burning Man every year, and whenever you hang out, they won't shut up about Burning Man, which makes you even more confident you will never go to Burning Man with them ever in your life. But, in fact, cool roofs are roofs that reflect the sun. They're a climate-friendly alternative to traditional air conditioning, which is actually pretty cool, but I'm still not going to Burning Man. Cool roofs are starting to be embraced all over the world, but can they actually make a difference? We went to see one of them up close in Madrid at the world's second largest fish market.